Dr. Anthony Fauci says Americans should be wearing masks when they're in public.
I do it when I'm in the public for the reasons that, A, I want to protect myself and protect others, and also because I want to make it be a symbol for people to see that that's the kind of thing you should be doing.
Dr. Fauci says while face masks aren't 100% effective, they're a valuable safeguard that also show respect for others.
I mean, masks are very important. They protect you from giving infection to someone else. If you happen to be inadvertently infected, and I'll get back to that in a moment, because there's such a significant percentage of the cases that are actually without symptoms. So anyone at any given time could be infected, don't even know it, and feel perfectly well.
This mother, Diane Downs, shot her kids at close range, drove them to the hospital while they bled all over the car, claimed a scraggy-haired stranger did it. And you'll see when you see the video, she can't even pretend to be an agonizing mother. What you want to look for here is an incredible discrepancy between horrific events that she describes and her very, very cool demeanor. And if you look closely, you'll see duping delight throughout this video.
But at night, when I close my eyes, I can see Christy reaching her hand out to me while I'm driving, and the blood just keep coming out of her mouth. And that, maybe it'll fade too with time, but I don't think so. That haunts me the most.
The economy is not going to be anything like it was. It's going to take a long time to recover. It's going to be, you know, people are going to be surprised at how slow and how fitful this is.
You know, fire, war, earthquakes. And so government, you know, Dr. Fauci is doing a very good job of saying the numbers are what count here. You know, if we have, you know, 1 in 10,000 side effects, that's, you know, way more, 700,000. You know, people who will suffer from that. You know, hopefully this will renew our sense that we're kind of in this together, you know, in our communities and our country. And, you know, we're all in this together. We've got to get rid of coronavirus from the entire world. That's a global problem. And, you know, so I'm glad, you know, that people are coming together. It won't go to zero, but it will shrink. Global GDP is going to take, you know, probably the biggest hit ever, and how hard it's going to be to get back to the normal life that we had before. For the world at large, normalcy only returns when we've largely vaccinated the entire global population.
Cases in many states, there's less than 200 cases right now. You're saying even in those states, the same kind of shutdown needs to occur?
Well, let's say you have 100 cases, and let's say you don't do a shutdown, then it grows 33% per day. So you take 100, you get 1,000, you get 10,000. It's exponential growth. 33% per day.
Say what now? What now?
33% per day.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I'm just going to ask you directly about this with regard to the flow of information. From the very beginning, you received a lot of criticism regarding that, in particular about Dr. Anthony Fauci. He is world-renowned in contagious diseases, and there were reports out there that he was being muzzled. Can you tell us that this widely respected expert, Dr. Fauci, will have every opportunity to tell us the truth?
Well, that's a very dishonest question, because he has had that ability to do virtually whatever he's wanted to do.
And
in fact, he was never muzzled.
Oh, no. Boy.
Take this mask and shove it. I ain't wearing it no more. Y'all look at me like I'm from Mars when I don't wear it in the store. Don't even try to make me put it on or I'm walking out the door. Take this mask and shove it. I ain't wearing it no more.
People and see if they have an idea of what's going on. Ma'am, were you let out of work early today? You're on live, Channel 11.
I was at the world. I was working. I work on 55 Water for TD Waterhouse. We saw the whole thing.
You saw everything.
The plane hit. We saw the second plane. We saw when the thing blew up, the fire, and we lost it. Everybody just left. That was it.
Can you just tell me, you were on the ground. Tell me your name.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Jeanette.
Jeanette.
Oh, God.
You're obviously...
Everyone should have a healthy distrust of the media. One of the most dangerous, unspoken things in existence in the world today is a media controlled by a very small group of corporate entities. Every day, we are constantly lied to and constantly told what to think, and most of us never even realize it. It's become a duty and call to action to wake people up to this reality. Before blindly listening to what's hurled at you, everyone has a personal responsibility to at least know what's going on before handing your mind over to the many forms of media indoctrination. In short, wake up. It becomes a frustrating experience to wake people up from the matrix, so to speak, and constantly overhear people all around still completely misdirected and mired in false narratives. The day after the attack in Paris, for example, almost everyone immediately began talking about how crazy people in the world are today, changing their profiles to French flags, and immediately posting support and condolences. And the irony was that no one had a clue about what really happened or why the entire world was made to watch. In addition to that, most people are lazy, distracted by a capitalistic existence, don't know they are brainwashed, and most times don't know what they are doing or why. Your thoughts are not your own, and you're being led by the hand every step of the way. Most people openly and defiantly do not trust their governments. People know better. However, simultaneously, they overtly trust each and everything their government does, says, and presents anyway. Because most people trust corporate news narratives, where they get most of their information, and never question any of it. Most people are still completely unaware that governments orchestrate and/or stage events all the time. This was always done throughout history and is still maintained today. This is nothing new under the sun. You can't even explain this to sheeple, because you might become the one under attack or ridiculed for trying to tell people the real truth. Unfortunately, we have a world of people who don't understand how the world works. The media is not for information, it's for indoctrination. It's owned and operated by a very small group, and the objective of news media is compromised. It's not about informing you about what's going on in the world. The main function is to carry out agendas and control what you think, how you behave, and what you believe.
We're in a live exercise here.
It began in healthy-looking pigs, months, perhaps years ago. A new coronavirus spread silently within herds. Gradually, farmers started getting sick. Infected people got a respiratory illness with symptoms ranging from mild flu-like signs to severe pneumonia. The sickest required intensive care, many died.
experts agree unless it is quickly controlled, it could lead to a severe pandemic, an outbreak that circles the globe and affects people everywhere.
The mission of the Pandemic Emergency Board is to provide recommendations to deal with the major global challenges arising in response to an unfolding pandemic. The board is comprised of highly experienced leaders from business, public health, and civil society.
We could be looking at double the number of cases in 1 week and 16 times as many in a month if we are not able to stop the spread. That would be on the order of 500,000 cases, and it would continue to rise exponentially. In 3 months, we could be approaching 10 million cases.
We're at the start of what's looking like it will be a severe pandemic. And there are problems emerging that can only be solved by global business and governments working together.
We have known about caps-like viruses in animals and people for decades, but have not been successful at developing a licensed vaccine. And sure, there are new technologies that may help, but it's going to be difficult. I am not optimistic about having a vaccine in time to be relevant during this pandemic.
So the policy crisis in question for this board in this meeting is this: how should governments, business, and international organizations allocate and distribute pandemic antivirals and medical supplies to the people who need the most?
What we've seen work very well in the HIV field is, in fact, procurement through the Global Fund. So having a centralized mechanism, so financially able to procure on behalf of affected countries, okay, would be critical. I think the second thing is it's going to be very important that for the business sector, for manufacturers of antivirals, that we have clarity around what the need is and where the need is and who are making the decisions.
I think that given that the countries most affected are those that are low and middle income countries with unequal access to technology, to finances, the UN has a worldwide footprint, universally recognized, and universal membership.
A global stockpile would certainly help ensure more rational and strategic allocation, but the reality is that we don't have the logistics capability, even within the UN, to bring that together in one place and run it. So this is where I think a collaboration between the international organizations like the World Health Organization and the private sector, which runs these supply chains for many purposes every day, understand where the supplies are, make smart decisions about how to allocate them to the people who need them in the places that need them the most, and then work with the industry to move those supplies from where they are today to where they need to be.
Just to underscore the point that cooperation among supply chain providers or businesses that have huge supply chains, mm-hmm, can add a lot of efficiency to the whole process.
The question is, can you, through this international mechanism, really promote commitments to doing this as quickly as possible and give people a sense that actually if they contribute more, that they will have a better chance of protecting their own populations and their country's security and health?
So to be completely clear, most of this production would already be committed in contracts.
Yes.
It is almost unheard of that people are producing product without having a forward commitment for the consumption of that product. So the first thing that needs to be done, because this is not something that the countries currently control, unless countries are going to bring about emergency situations and co-opt an existing supply chain.
I think it's not likely, I agree, that countries are not going to buy a countermeasure to put into a global supply without retaining a large portion of it for themselves.
Public health agencies have issued travel advisories, while some countries have banned travel from the worst affected areas. As a result, the travel sector is taking a huge hit. Travel bookings are down 45%, and many flights have been canceled. A ripple effect is racing through the service sector. Governments that rely on travel and tourism as a large part of their economies are being hit particularly hard.
How should national leaders, businesses and international organizations balance the risk of worsening disease that would be caused by the continued movement of people around the world against the risks of profound economic consequence of travel and trade bans.
If there's some sense that there's a UN institution that can do all of this, then I worry we're suffering from a delusional disorder on the power of the UN. It's really important to get those industries and their trade associations and an efficient leadership established, which is decentralized, but has a collective responsibility and accountability. And that needs to be supported by the public leadership.
What is essential, what is non-essential travel, we have to clarify this. Otherwise, if we go down to 20% bookings over a long period, the company will run down. That's a fact.
You know, there's a whole complex set of issues in a highly interdependent world on supply chains that are just in time. We need to think about how much flex there is in that just-in-time supply chain system and make sure it keeps running. I think it's going to take specificity, and it's going to take knowledge that only the private sector has. The UN can play an important coordinating facilitation role, but the companies know where those commodities are, where they move, how to move them. And that's where a type of public-private collaboration that we have not generally had in these crises needs to be put together pretty quickly.
Take this mask and shove it. I ain't wearing it no more. The panic done left and took all the reasons I was a-worrying for. You better not try to stand in my way as I play inside the door. Take this mask and shove it. I ain't wearing it no more. Well, the government, it's a regular dog. The tattletales, they are fools. Got a brand new unfair law. Lord, they think they're cool. One of these days I'm gonna blow my top and those suckers, they're gonna pay. Lord, I can't wait to see their faces when I shove my guitar in their A. Take this mask and shove it, I ain't wearing it no more. The panic done left and took all the reasons I was a-worrying for. You better not try to stand in my way as I play inside the door. Take this mask and shove it. I ain't wearing it no more. Take this mask and shove it.
Excuse me.
I ain't wearing it no more.
Do you understand that?
You're violating my constitutional
rights. Okay, well, this is private property.
This private has food. I have a right to buy food without being forced to participate in a fake global false flag pandemic.
We are not out of money yet, but the fact is we are trending in a dangerous direction and something needs to change.
So the policy question for this board now is how should financial resources be prioritized? Are there nodes that we cannot allow to fail? What is your sense of priorities? We don't have money to pay for all of these urgent problems.
So at the moment, we want the funds, right? You need the money. So where's the money? So government kind of supplies some money. A lot of, you know, private sectors, you know, some city here, you have some money. But now you need a really coordinated, centralized efforts.
Hotels will be experiencing, you know, crippling losses doing that. And we know that the hotel business in itself makes up 5% of the GDP.
Governments need to be willing to do things that are out of their historical perspective, or for the most part, it's really a war footing that we need to be on.
We shouldn't underestimate the power of entrepreneurship. We need to escalate that, whether it's through, you know, the government's helping with tax breaks or, you know, subsidies of that nature to increase manufacturing of those types of products. It can happen quickly. A Marshall-type plan, you know, don't mean to say that exactly, but a Marshall plan that can go into effect can stimulate change very quickly.
Countries are reacting in different ways as to how best to manage the overwhelming amounts of dis and misinformation circulating over the internet. In some cases, limited internet shutdowns are being implemented to quell panic.
How much control of information should there be, and by whom? And how can false information be effectively challenged? And what if that false information is coming from companies or from governments?
I think it's very important that we make sure that there is concise communication with all healthcare facilities where these patients are being treated so that there isn't mass panic.
We're at a moment where the social media platforms have to step forward and recognize the moment to assert that they're a technology platform and not a broadcaster is over. They, in fact, have to be a participant in broadcasting accurate information and partnering with the scientific and health communities to counterweight, if not flood the zone, of accurate information, because to put the genie back in the bottle of the misinformation and disinformation is nigh impossible.
One thing we haven't spoken about, and I'm wondering whether it's time to talk about this, is a step up from the part of the governments on enforcement actions against fake news.
I personally do not believe that trying to shut things down in terms of information is either practical or desirable. And we do have, I think, a couple of strategies that are available to us, one of which is the flood strategy, second of which is relying and informing and equipping trusted sources of information with the facts so they can then pass that on. But we also need to actually think about a technological answer to this.
The outcome of the CAPS pandemic in event 201 was catastrophic. 65 million people died in the first 18 months. The outbreak was small at first and initially seemed controllable, but then it started spreading in densely crowded and impoverished neighborhoods of megacities. From that point on, the spread of the disease was explosive. Within 6 months, cases were occurring in nearly every country. The global economy was in a free fall. The GDP down 11%. Stock markets around the world plummeted between 20 and 40% and headed into a downward cycle of fear and low expectation. Businesses were not borrowing, banks were not lending. Everyone was just hoping to hunker down and weather the storm. Economists say the economic turmoil caused by such a pandemic will last for years, perhaps a decade. The societal impacts, the loss of faith in government, the distrust of news, and the breakdown of social cohesion could last even longer. We have to ask, did this need to be so bad? Are there things we could have done in the 5 to 10 years leading up to the pandemic that would have lessened the catastrophic consequences? We believe the answer is yes. So are we, as a global community, now finally ready to do the hard work needed to prepare for the next pandemic?
People and see if they have an idea of what's going on. Ma'am, were you let out of work early today? You're on live, Channel 11.
I work on 55 Water for TD Waterhouse. We saw the whole thing.
You saw everything.
The plane hit. We saw the second plane. We saw when the thing blew up, the fire, and we lost it. Everybody just left. That was it.
Can you just tell me, you were on the ground. Tell me your name.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Jeanette.
Jeanette.
Oh, God.
You're obviously...
Are you stupid or something?
I'm as stupid as a stupid does.
Are you crazy? Or just plain stupid?
Stupid as a stupid does, Miss Blue.
I guess.
Are you stupid or something?
Stupid as a stupid does, sir.
Ron. Hello.
I've been thinking about you and I don't even know your name.
Larry. Larry Crown. Hi. This is,
Lala.
Lala.
Larry and Lala. I don't think so. I used to be Catherine until I looked in the mirror and saw a girl named Talia. You? Lance Corona. Who's cutting my clap? Where's Larry Crown?
Remember, you got the flu.
We're on Tom Hanks's Instagram.
And you may want to be sitting down watching this video. You will not believe this one. So, of course, as some of you know, Tom Hanks contracted the so-called virus in Australia. All right, and apparently Tom Hanks is a lover of typewriters. You know, he's a typewriter aficionado, collector. So let's see what happened on this Instagram post here. Hey folks, good news. 1 week after testing positive in self-isolation, the symptoms are much the same. No fever, but the blahs. Folding the laundry and doing the dishes leads to a nap on the couch. Bad news, my wife, Rita Wilson, has won 6, of course, straight hands of gin rummy and leads by 201 points. Leads by 201 points. But I have learned not to spread my Vegemite so thick. I traveled here with a typewriter. He traveled there with one typewriter. Okay? And one I used to love. Used to love. You know why he's saying used to love? Well, we'll get to that in a second. We're all in this together. Flatten the curve, of course. So, can you guess which typewriter brand he so happened to travel with and had with him as he contracted this deadly virus? You guessed it. Corona. Corona. Corona typewriter, folks. And for those of you unaware of the significance of the 201 reference, just a friendly reminder. And for those people out there, and there are many, who are questioning this, looking into this, skeptical about this situation, pointing out all of the suspicious coincidences, quote unquote, online since this so-called outbreak began, these people are aware of something called Event 201, which is a little mock simulation exercise that they carried out less than 2 months before this so-called outbreak that's playing out exactly in the real world right now as if it was some sort of script.
And finally, I want to talk about the disinformation that people are seeing both on Twitter and around the world, some of it coming from government, some of it coming from other individuals. Just urge everyone, as they're seeing information, information that at one time suggested somehow this virus emanated from the United States Army, this information about lockdowns that are taking place, every American, indeed, people all around the world should ensure that where they turn to for information is a reliable source and not a bad actor trying to create and flow information that they know is wrong. This is a tough fight. The American people are tougher. Our diplomatic teams are working around the clock to help them keep safe both home and abroad. And we're showing once again the global leadership that America has always delivered. And it's been great to see countries around the world rally behind what President Trump and our team are doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you.
Yes, go ahead, Jim.
As you basically informed some people what happened, assuming some people had no idea what was happening, what kinds of reactions are you getting from people?
You're going to the second tower. You're looking at this right now.
Okay.
Both towers now completely destroyed of the World Trade Center. You have no idea how many people may have been in those buildings. We have no idea. This is a major communication center for this city, for this country. Many government offices in those towers. Amazing video as you're watching it now. It's not video, it's live. It's right before your very eyes.
I want you to listen to me because I'm only going to say this once. Never, ever trust the news again.
I'm
only is it the same crisis actress, but I don't even know how many different things, like it's 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 different fake hoax shootings, gun grabs. And then this video I found that I've seen the video enough times of the original of this whole thing. And I could tell right away that it had been manipulated. And so I put this little thing together with the, I say real, I don't know that that's real. That's original, or the original release version, okay? And then they have the remastered version, the digitally altered, morphed, face swapped, whatever version on the right there. And you may say that it's the aspect ratio, but you know, they have the globe back there, and the globe is circular, it's round in both versions, and so it tells me that they only digitally manipulated the face. They made the teeth bigger, they did certain things to make them look different.
The worst days of my life. I guess I didn't know how much one person can love another until you just don't know where they're at. You just have no idea. And I'm just hoping for a sign of some sort that he's okay. And I believe in God, and I believe that God is with him, and that is what I hold on to. That is where my hope comes from.
My heart is with you, Emily, and I can't even pretend to understand what this is like for you. Let's remain optimistic. If he's okay, you know, and in that first phone call with him, what's the first thing you're going to tell him?
That God is our savior, and that if we can make it through this, then there's nothing that can stand between us. And I just cannot wait to see his smile, and I'm just in hope that that time will come very shortly. And
Emily Eisenman, I am thinking only happy thoughts for you. Thank you so much for the time. Let's stay in touch.
The only way to really cure that was on the inside is understanding that Jesus Christ died for our sins. And so to me, on a micro level, it's understanding.
And just like that, we lost him. I know, I heard you guys rapping me.
Hi, I'm Fox San Antonio's Jessica Headley.
And I'm Ryan Wolf.
Our greatest responsibility is to serve our Treasure Valley communities.
The El Paso, Las Cruces communities.
Eastern Iowa communities.
Mid-Michigan communities.
We are extremely proud of the quality, balanced journalism that CBS 4 News produces.
But
we are concerned about trouble and trying to be responsible, one-sided news stories plaguing our country.
Plaguing our country.
In my line of work, you got to keep repeating things over and over and over again for the truth to sink in, to kind of catapult the propaganda.
We're in a live exercise here.